young and poor, is very, very important to an artist. The things I like about my life, of course, half of it's fiction, is thinking of myself as being young and poor in those days. Well, now I'm old and fat and rich. And one feels, I wouldn't like to really to be poor now in these conditions, but you'd be less of a whore, really, you know. I ran away from home because I didn't want to go on the land. And it's the only way I could really see of sort of becoming free. And I wasn't a victim of the Depression. I was just a person living then. I could have got off at any time I wanted to.
He's about 14, 15, when he was at Cranbrook. And that would have been when he was at home on a weekend and he had his sports coat on.
From boarding school, Donald wrote, "Managed to get home and go with mother to see Pavlova, the Russian dancer, whom I consider immortal. Am confirmed this night by the Archbishop of Sydney. Am horribly impressed and reformed to a monstrous degree."
And he studied etching under...
Assistant curator, Amanda Beresford, looks at some family photographs with Donald's sister Gwen, who chose a career in theatre and radio.
My darling mother.
Your mother, she looks
elegant,
so...
Elegant, elegant lady. And through her, in the good days, you know, before things became a bit rough, through her parties and things, was when Donald and all me too, all of us, were introduced to the art and theatre and music world.
I, Donald Stuart Leslie Friend, under His Gracious Majesty George V, declare this diary unto my mother on this merry first day of the year 1929.
It was through her that he started his painting.
She encouraged him.
She did indeed. When he was very young, when we were at Glendon, there were very old convict-built rooms, which were servants' rooms and whatnot, and she gave him a studio.
Well, I was the son of very well-to-do people on the land, sheep and cattle and all of that sort of thing. And my mother was quite intelligent, quite well-read. Her side of the family were. Her father's side were not. And I really wanted, then roundabout when I was 14 or so, nothing except to be an artist.
What did your father think about it?
Oh, he loathed it. He wouldn't have it. No. He was in the country on the land, and no son of mine's going to be a bloody painter. Well, that was that. And he was sort of cut off without an allowance and all that sort of thing. So mother said, the hell with that, and that was when Donald went bush.
Became, after Queensland.
Became a, well, virtually a swaggy, I suppose, and bummed his way around Australia.
Yes.
Always with a postal note at the right post office.
From mother?
Per mother. That... is my father. And he had no time for art or music or ballet or theatre or anything like that. The day they were married, her mother was always aware that he was a philanderer.
Mm.
Or in the good Rabelaisian days, they used to say he was a good stallion.
Mm.
There are the boys. There's Harley and Donald, this marvellous train.
Mm. Oh, look at their little shorts. Aren't they beautiful?
Yes, mother dressed them beautifully, didn't she? And that's our nanny, dear.
Oh, yes.
And there is my grandmother Moses, whom I ever saw once in my life.
Grandfather, Henry Moses, played cricket for Australia in 1886-87. One of the best left-handed batsmen Australia has produced, writes Jack Pollard in his anthology Australian Cricket. There is also a reference to the decision to change the family name and an acknowledgement of the famous grandson.
When I was about 2 years old, my father changed the name because it was the only way of inheriting the Friend money, because they wouldn't leave it to anyone with the name of Moses, because they'd had some terrible row with old great-grandfather. He was a born will rattler. He used to have terrible arguments with his sons and grandsons about cricket. He'd just say, well, if you don't, if you think like that, I'll send for my lawyer tomorrow. And he would, and cut them out of his will, you see. I went through this studio and every folio in it, etc. And I tore up, I suppose must have been at least 200 drawings and sketches. All we painters should do it. At least once a year, or some of them once a week. It's terrible to have really rotten early work sort of coming up and staring at you in the face. You can't destroy it then because it belongs to somebody else. It's their great art treasure. I think it'd be a marvellous idea if some artists got together, formed a society to meet one day every year, say in the Domain, and bring all of their bad works and have a bonfire of them. It would be lovely, and there'd be lots of dealers there saying, oh no, don't burn that, you know, being terribly distressed, seeing yet another Nolan or something burst into flames. It'd do Australian art a tremendous lot of good. No painting, well, that I've done, has been entirely satisfactory anyway. It's sort of a an attempt at sort of getting towards, it's like trying to remember a dream. You know, you can only remember little bits of it, and you can't really explain them.
The truth of the artist is in the legacy of prodigious works. But in Donald Friend, we will always have the enigma. On a flyleaf in one of Donald's diaries is this annotation. Like all young men, I set out to be a genius. But laughter mercifully intervened.